The following Truth Barista podcast is a High B Ministry production.
Most people divorce before they should. You can tell when you're ready for divorce when you have no unfinished emotional business. You shouldn't get a divorce when you're upset. You shouldn't get a divorce until you have turned over every rock looking for solutions, till you have examined every possible avenue of rehabilitation.
Welcome to the Ersatz Coffee Shop. This is Jay, your Truth Barista, and I'm serving up a steamy cup of God's truth for the average Joe. You can catch me and this podcast on my websites, truthbarista.com, all one word, truthbarista.com, and highbeamministry.com. That's H-I-G-H-B-E-A-M ministry.com, as in car high beam. We're shining the light of God's truth on the road ahead.
Hey, Amazing Larry, why don't you come on over to the anointed booth? I got something great for you today.
Oh, and you have a warm kolache for me, or one of those sugar-covered donuts? What do you got?
No, I've got something even better. Really? I've got Bible teaching. What?
Well, I was just kind of hoping I'd have something to warm my tummy.
Okay. Amazing Larry, turn around and look over in the corner.
Yeah.
You see that bakery case over there?
Yeah,
go get yourself a kolache.
All right.
You can have all the kolaches you want. Today is
kolache
Friday
day.
Free kolache day.
Oh, wow.
In fact, I've even ordered in a Mexican band, and we're going to call it Mariachi Kolache Day.
Woohoo! Wow.
Okay. No. Okay. We won't do the mariachi band. Okay. But I do have some really good stuff. Now, do you remember over the last number of weeks, and how could you forget, we've been talking about Jesus doing away with the law, right? And we came to the conclusion that Jesus didn't do away with the law. In fact, he came to interpret it and apply it correctly. That's where we've been, right?
Oh, yeah. And we came to the conclusion, obviously, that he couldn't do away with really himself.
Exactly.
Because he became the walking Torah, as John 1 tells us. So, yeah.
Yeah, he's the walking word of God. He's the perfect reflection of God. Why would he do away with himself? So, that makes him the most qualified person to teach on the Torah, to teach about the law.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, last couple of weeks, we talked about how he taught the law regarding murder. And what does it come down to? The heart. Then he talks about adultery, because, you know, thou shalt not commit adultery, right? One of the big 10. And where does that one start, Amazing Larry?
Well, it would be the heart, Truth
Barista. Exactly. Now he moves to the question of divorce, which I find really funny, because in today's society, some people take divorce much too casually. And some people treat divorce too extremely.
Sweetheart, we're married.
Consider that a divorce.
Now, Jesus has the right way to approach divorce. So I want you to open up your Bible now to Matthew 5, verse 31. And then I'm also going to dip into Matthew 19, because that expands more of his teaching on divorce. You got it?
It's showtime.
I got it. So let's talk about this, just unwrap it just a little bit further. Why is divorce such a big thing? I mean, it is a big thing today, because about 51% of us get divorced, at least for the first time, and it's like 66% a second time. But back then, you would think that culture wasn't quite so, easygoing on things like this. Why is this a problem?
Well, that's true, but actually divorce was much easier in ancient times and much more brutal. I hate to tell you that. In fact, well, I've got some stuff right here I'm going to show you from one of the ancient law codes, what you could do for divorce. In fact, when we begin to look at what Jesus taught about divorce, he's not making it easier. Again, he's getting to the heart of the matter, and he's setting the bar higher. And he's really calling people out on their personal, how can I say this, their personal heart, attitude, convictions. I mean, he's really getting to the heart of the matter, I guess.
But he isn't necessarily protecting the institution. solution, is he? Or is he protecting the family and the children against what divorce does to them?
He is protecting marriage. That's what we're going to see.
Okay. Which is protecting the family and the children. Because, you know,
people
say all the time, it's just a piece of paper, Truth Barista. So right. Why should I just get married? It's just a piece of paper. But that's not what marriage and divorce is all about. It's about protecting the family against the kinds of things that divorce brings into their lives.
Exactly. Divorce is not a simple, you don't have simple, easy divorce. It's basically, I don't want to give away too much right away of what's coming because I like the impact of the surprise. But marriage is a covenant. God takes covenants and promises extremely seriously. And when you break your marriage vows, you are breaking a covenant, a solemnly sworn before the Lord covenant. And that is a very serious thing. In fact, God looks at Israel as his wife. And in the Old Testament, in the Hebrew scriptures, God continually goes after Israel saying, you're committing adultery by committing idolatry. You're chasing other gods and betraying me and your covenant vows to me. And by doing that, you're betraying me. But I forgive you, come back. You're betraying me again. Now, confess your sin, repent, and come back. And he keeps calling Israel back. It wasn't until they got to a point where God says, I have had it. Your heart has turned from me. Now you need to suffer the consequences. And the consequences is a separation of the relationship. And that really is a consequence of divorce, isn't it?
It is.
When you separate from your husband to your wife, there's a breakdown of a relationship that often brings grief. When parents get divorced, there is a separation of relationship and stability for children. In fact, I've got that kind of thing happening in close relationship, family relationships at this moment, and it's going to bring grief to the children.
Well, so in other words, you're talking separation, but doesn't the Bible say that he actually divorced Israel?
He did, and he remarried her. In fact, the whole book of Hosea is about God saying, okay, Hosea, you go marry that prostitute. And I'm thinking, why? Why marry the prostitute? Well, the point is he wanted Hosea to marry a woman whose heart, let's say, drawn to other men, because God was going to make a point. He knew that the woman would turn her back on Hosea, which she did, so he rightly divorced her. Well, then God says, go back and make her your wife again. So Hosea goes back, and it's like she doesn't even repent. You don't even hear anything about her repenting. God just says, go back, make her your wife again, and love her. And he's going, okay, so he does. And God goes, here's my point. Israel has committed adultery. I will divorce her, in other words, send her away. But after a time, my love is still for her. I will draw her back to me. And I will woo her all over again, and I will restore this relationship that we have. I mean, how many husbands or wives in a divorce act that way? For most of them, it's like, okay, we're divorced, hit the road. So you get the idea. So I want to talk about Jesus' teaching on divorce. It's not going to be complete. It's not going to be total, but I'm going to give you some principles as we go through.
Okay,
and
great.
We may have to do this in two Fridays. I'm just saying.
Sure.
Okay?
Sure.
Okay. So what's really important about this section is that when Christians read it, many Christians at heart really don't want to intentionally sin, especially in this area of divorce. Now, we know as Christians, we do sin. We do intentionally sin. But divorce is a big deal because that sin that we see divorce is has repercussions. It's like throwing a rock into a pond, right? So you get divorced from your spouse. It affects her family. It affects your family. It affects her friends and your friends and all of the children and the parents above. And I mean, all sorts of stuff.
But that is what they call grace, Truth Barista. I don't like my spouse anymore because I can't get along with them. So God gives me grace. He'll forgive me for my actions because I can't live like this anymore. I'm not going to work on it. I'm done. I mean, isn't that a misuse of grace?
We have to understand where grace fits into this and the sin that's a part of divorce. See, I'm not being specific because I'm going to take you somewhere with this.
Because
we have to see where divorce comes from. And once we get it in that viewpoint, hopefully it will defuse a lot of people saying, well, divorce is a sin. And the problem is people who have become divorced and don't understand Jesus' teachings on divorce can walk around for the rest of their lives feeling condemned. And in many churches, if you're a divorced person, you stand condemned. It's almost like divorce is the unforgivable sin in the church. And then if you want to get remarried in some denominations, in some churches, people say, well, you can't, because as long as your spouse, your divorced spouse, is alive, then you would be committing adultery. So now you've condemned people to a lonely life without an intimate relationship, a deep friendship with another person of the opposite sex, and they live a miserable life for the rest of their life. They stand condemned.
Well, but Jesus, though, in Matthew 5, verse 31, talks about the exception. The exception, right, that he gives that divorce would be okay, correct?
That is correct. And it's kind of funny. Here's the flow. You know, Jesus talks about murder, and it all comes down to the heart. He talks about adultery, and it all comes down to the heart. And he slides right into the topic of divorce. Isn't that interesting? Divorce, with his little caveat of adultery here, is linked to his previous teachings on adultery. So in one case, it's like, well, maybe the cause of divorce is that adultery. And so rather than looking at the act of adultery, maybe we should go back and look at the heart that led to the adultery, that led to the undermining of the marriage, that led to the breakdown of the marriage. So divorce, is it the sin, or is the heart the start of the sin and the breakdown of the relationship, mm-hmm, and the refusal to reconcile the sin?
Well, it's a very interesting proposition, because the 10th commandment talks about coveting, right? Coveting, don't
That's
covet
right.
your neighbor's wife, which, yep, obviously was a problem because he put it in the Big Ten.
Well, as we know, having talked about this whole idea about adultery and lust, it ain't limited to men. And we know that human beings are, I mean, their sex drive is one of the foundational drives that God gave us when he said, reproduce and rule the world. So you got to deal with that sex drive righteously.
Well, there's another drive that we have too, that God put in us, I think.
I know.
It's called
the caffeine drive.
Well, we'll come back and talk more about this in just a second. Truth Barista, you know, this particular podcast has so much good value to it. In fact, I was talking to somebody the other day, and they said this: you deal with topics I don't hear in church. What do you think of that?
I think that's great, and that's exactly what we do. Why? Well, you know, in some churches, pastors have a lot of responsibility, a lot of people to answer to. They've got a lot of things to do, and there are some biblical truths that go unaddressed for various reasons. And what we like to do is we like to fill in the gap. We're here to add value to the come alongside pastors and address maybe some hot topics that they can't or won't address. We want to hit those hot topics head on, because the body needs to hear the whole truth and nothing but the truth.
And that's what they will hear when they tune in, because after all, you are the Truth Barista. You come up with the best topics and the best solutions to the things that people are really struggling with in society, in their minds, or in their practice.
We don't proclaim to know the whole truth here, but
right,
we do know the truth, and we just discuss and we ruminate and we mull over all these topics to give people something to think about, but we always try to keep it thoroughly grounded on God's truth. So if you're listening to the Truth Barista podcast, this can be great for just you or small groups, home groups when you're out on a walk or when you're biking. Could even be used as a pulpit filler, who knows? But we're here to teach on various topics, and we don't shy away from any of them.
So you can take the Truth Barista podcast and you can share it with your friends, and the whole podcast really is designed and produced by High Beam Ministry. And what is High Beam Ministry?
Well, High Beam Ministry is about shining the light of God's truth on the road ahead. We need God's truth to guide us through life and through a variety of media: the Truth Barista podcast, the Frothy Thoughts blog, video classes, online teachings. We bring it all. And the web address is highbeamministry.com, highbeamministry.com.
All right.
Okay.
Boy, that was good. That drive was good. That was worth it.
That's right. Now I'm driven to teach here. Okay, jump into your Bible, Matthew 5:31, and then I'm going to jump to Matthew 19, starting at verse 3. And listen very carefully as I read, because there are key words that we're going to hit as we go through here. I'll reference back to them. Okay, so here we go. It has been said, anyone who divorces his wife must give her a certificate of divorce. But I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except for immorality, makes her the victim of adultery, and anyone who marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Now, this is the Christian Standard Bible that I'm reading from, okay? Mm-hmm. It's a little like the New King James, but it's smoothed in its translation a little bit, okay?
Okay.
Now we jump to Matthew 19, verse 3. Some Pharisees came to him, Jesus, to test him. In other words, what they did is they put it as a Jewish legal question to a rabbi. Mm-hmm. You know, we got this question about the law, rabbi, but it's actually a test, okay? It's actually a trap, and I'll explain why. They asked, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any and every reason? That's very important. Hold that in your head. Verse 4, haven't you read, he replied, meaning Jesus, that at the beginning the Creator made them male and female? And said, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Or some people say, let no man separate, no human being separate. Verse 7, why then, they asked, did Moses command that a man give his wife a certificate of divorce and send her away? Verse 8, Jesus replied, Moses permitted you to divorce your wives because your hearts, there's the issue, were hard. But it was not this way from the beginning. I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, and marries another woman, commits adultery. Okay, putting this all together into one thing, it's kind of complex, but I'm going to attempt a basic, clear answer. And I'm not going to cover all the bases with you, Amazing Larry. We can do that during the week as we discuss this, right? But I just want to talk about what Jesus is dealing with, and I'll do a little nod to Paul. But the basic starting point, of course, is always context. What's going on in the background? Now, how do you understand everything that I've read here? How does that speak to you?
Well, it says that there's a process to divorce. Now, I don't know what that certificate meant, if it was just a matter of going to the rabbi and the rabbi signed something or gave his blessing to the divorce, but there had to be a process before the divorce was actually given. So that's okay. That's the first part.
That is. Now, that's very insightful because that is key. There is a process that leads to divorce. But funny, it's not the process of divorce, it's the stuff that leads to the divorce. That's the process.
Well, but the other part of that process is the process that's going on in the heart of one or the other spouse, mostly the man, I think. He can divorce his wife for any reason. Any cause. But again, and I know we've talked about this in the past, we don't insert women there. So they were probably not given that same option. For any cause, you could get rid of the husband. At least it's not in the text.
Now, you've hit it because, again, getting back to context, yeah, the Torah was given in a patriarchal society, a man-led society. And so, of course, the men would take the lead in divorcing their wives. So let me go back. Let me put it into context and we'll deal with the question. Ready?
Got it.
Marriage. That was God's plan from the very beginning. That's what Jesus said, Matthew 19, 4 through 5. You look at Genesis. She was made for him. He split a person. He took a whole person, split them in halves, filled in the two halves. And so these two filled in halves are two whole people, but you don't get the whole picture until the two people come together in one relationship and actually physically become one. So this is what Jesus is hammering with this. It says it's a unity that should not be dissolved. Divorce was never God's plan, and God does not condone divorce. However, he does know about divorce because why? Israel is his bride. And he's the bridegroom, okay? However, God has allowed it. Remember, Jesus said Moses permitted it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, why? Because God knows how hard our hearts are. And there comes a point when you have willingly irreconcilable differences, okay? So let's talk about marriage and God's Torah requirements, okay? Here we go. No adultery, No cheating. Okay. If a man marries a woman, and by the way, this goes back to Deuteronomy 24:1. Listen to this. If a man marries a woman who becomes displeasing to him because he finds something indecent about her, and he writes her a certificate of divorce, gives it to her, and sends her away from his house. Okay, question for you, Amazing Larry. What is the something indecent about her?
It could have been anything. She could have started growing warts. She could have gotten too fat. You know, she could be going bald. Something wasn't displeasing to him. And probably, I mean, I'm sorry about this, but it's probably sexual more than it was she was just a bad housekeeper. But it could have been she was a bad housekeeper too. But okay, I would say it was physical.
Right, but you're kind of referencing physically. What about she had a bad attitude?
Yeah, that's true.
What if she was a nag?
Ooh.
Okay.
Well, that requires murder.
Sweetheart, we're married.
Consider that a divorce.
Now you're kind of dealing with what the rabbis noticed and had to deal with. What is this something indecent? I mean, what determines that? Okay, I'll get to that in a second. By the way, literally, that something indecent means in the Hebrew, a thing of nakedness or a cause of sexual immorality. Okay, so now we're not talking a beauty thing. What we're talking about is a relationship thing, in some way committing a sexual immorality.
Or is it because he doesn't find her attractive anymore, or she's not a sexual thing as he thought? I mean, I'm just thinking like a man, because a man would say, well, gee, she's just not a good sex partner. I mean, I don't want to be crass with that, but isn't that a reason why some men would want to get rid of their wives?
Oh, heck, I mean, I've heard my friends, and in counseling, I've heard other people say that. But on the other hand, I hear women turn it around on men and say, well, he's not a decent sex partner because he's not engaged emotionally with me. He just wants to use me as a toy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah. Where's the tenderness? Where's the compassion? Mm-hmm. Where's the engagement?
Mm-hmm.
I love the book. There's a great book out there. It's called Sex Begins in the Kitchen.
Kevin Lehman.
Yeah, it is a hilarious book because he says, guys, sex doesn't begin in the bedroom. Sex begins in the kitchen when you do the dishes for your wife. Mm. And he goes, you're kind of priming the pump.
Wow. I never thought about that. I'm taking out the garbage, dear.
And that also kind of ties into the five love languages book. I mean, sex wasn't made as a standalone. Sex was to be the outworking of the love and the intimacy and the relationship and the trust and the sincerity and the comfort that a husband and wife have with one another and the warmth and the joy that they find in each other. So it wasn't the whole thing. It was kind of like the conclusion of a great day, you know, kind of a thing. Right? It could be a start of a great day, but we'll keep going on here. Okay, moving along. Note, by the way, in this, it's about a woman, something indecent, not the man. Why? Because in those days, a man was allowed polygamy, which was multiple wives.
Hmm.
So this was kind of like, well, I'll marry this one. Well, something is indecent about her, so I don't want to get rid of her, so I'll just marry somebody else, you know, and that kind of a thing. So that's the context we're dealing with. However, the Torah, the law, did demand that the husband, if he's going to get into a marriage relationship, he had to provide food, clothing, and marital relationships with her. So verse 10, if he marries another woman, he must not deprive the first one of her food, clothing, marital rights. We talked about that in the previous one. That's love, honor, and cherish in today's terms. If he does not provide her with these three things, she is to go free without any payment of money. Now, you said that women couldn't divorce the men. Well, here they can.
Hmm.
Because if he refuses to provide the basics for her, which is to food, clothing, and marital rights, which is an intimacy and an emotional thing, then she can just say, okay, I'm done. And I have the proof. See ya.
Well, so what you're saying then is that, you know, a modern woman and an ancient woman were two different people in terms of how they viewed sex. Because it sounds like the one woman who's being divorced could still hang around, even though she was rejected by him as his wife, but could still hang around in the back bedroom and have all the privileges she had as his wife. I know why they did it, because she didn't have any other income, or she would be, you know, destitute at that point. But it just seems like she was really losing out so much on that, isn't she?
Well, that's an important point. that you brought up, because a woman needed support in those days. A woman was either under the support of her father, or she was under support of a husband, because the father and the husbands were the main breadwinners. And if father died, she's under the, if you want to say, the care and support of her brother. As a, you know, the firstborn son's job was to take care of any unmarried women in his family. Okay, so you hit it kind of coming around the other side. Okay, the first verse about something indecent about the woman means she needs to remain faithful. In this verse, the man owes her support. So she owes faithfulness. He owes support. If you put this together into one, as a man and a woman are one, then they are to be faithful to each other and support each other. That's kind of like the bedrock of a solid foundation of a marriage, is mutual support, mutual faithfulness. Now, what if they didn't do this? Aha! Now we get to the Torah's law on divorce. It says in Deuteronomy 24, verse 1, here, if he finds something indecent about her, or if there's some cause, he writes her a certificate of divorce and gives it to her and sends her from his house. Now, there were two schools of thought in Jesus' day. So think of it in today's terms. You have, you know, on some deep theological issue or something, you have the Catholic perspective and you have the Protestant perspective. Or in these terms, in some Protestant denominations, you have the liberal perspective and you have the conservative perspective. And I'm not talking politics. Some, you know, would be a little more loose. Some would be a little more strict. Well, in Jesus' day, they had those exact same two schools. Number one, you had the school of Rabbi Hillel. He was much more loose about what something indecent meant. What's the cause of a divorce? For Shammai, Rabbi Shammai, he was much more strict about it. So Shammai ruled on this verse in Deuteronomy 24, you could only be divorced if she committed adultery, that's it. Hillel said, well, if she wrecks your meal.
Wow.
I mean, that's how loose. If she burns your toast, or if there's something you just don't like about her, you can get rid of her. That's how kind of loose this was. Mm. And that put these two schools at odds. Now, the Pharisees had a tendency to follow Shammai's more conservative rules. The Sadducees had a tendency to follow Hillel's more loose rules in general. Okay, so you had these two schools of thought fighting against each other. So here's the test that they were posing to Jesus. Okay, the test implies a question with a malicious intent. Why did they test him with the divorce question? Why was that such a big deal? Because in Jesus' day, King Herod, and who was an Idumean, a ruler of the Jews, went to Rome and he met a lady named Herodias, his half-brother Philip's wife. Okay. After he seduces Herodias, he divorced his own wife and married her. And remember John the Baptist? He rebuked this Herod for marrying Philip's wife because it was totally lawless. Okay. And what happened to John because of this?
Well, he lost his head over the whole thing.
Herod killed him.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Herod killed him.
Yeah.
Okay. So obviously, if you kind of question the divorce thing and come on the wrong side of Herod's actions, you're risking death. Okay. So here's to kind of draw it to a close before we have to go to the back to work here. Two things are in play to trap Jesus. Number one, which rabbinic camp of the Torah was he on? Hillel's loose side or Shammai's strict side? Either side would wind up attacking him. Number two, if Jesus was strict, then his view would condemn Herod as John the Baptist did, and they could all then rat on Jesus, and he could face imprisonment and even death like John. In other words, they tested him in order to get rid of Jesus. They weren't interested in divorce. They weren't interested in marriage. They're interested in getting rid of Jesus. But Jesus turns around, gets out of it, and winds up actually establishing marriage and divorce principles.
Well, and we're going to have to unpack that next time we get together, because I'm interested. I got a lot of questions, Truth Barista, about this. And I think we're just going to... So before we leave, give us one last thought as you kind of condense all of what you've been saying today in a sentence or two. Give us something to leave with.
Okay. Divorce is not as simple as you think it is. Divorce in and of itself is not as sinful as you think it is. Okay, I'm going to let you mull on that one. And number two, the thing I want to get at next week is, what are the grounds for divorce? What are they asking Jesus about this, and how does he reply? So I'm going to let you mull that over.
Oh, I just love it. I'll mull it over as I do the dishes here.
The prophets of God were accurate when they spoke about the Messiah. They were accurate about his rejection by men and that he would be a man of sorrows. They were accurate when they said he bore the sins of many and became the Savior of the world. Thanks for joining us.
This is Jay, your Truth Barista. Thanks for listening to the Truth Barista podcast. The best way to find out when a new podcast drops is through RSS feed. Go to our website, look for the RSS button, press it, and then enter your email. You'll be notified when a new podcast drops. Thanks for listening.